We'd like to welcome everyone that have been watching college football. You're now tuned in to the Old Spice Classic. Creighton Xavier, loser's bracket of the Old Spice Classic. My name is Lou Canellis. Lenny Elmore alongside. Xavier lost yesterday in the first round to Marquette, 71-61. And Creighton, with a huge opportunity, let it slip by, losing to Michigan 83-76 in overtime in yesterday's game.
And when you talk about Creighton, you're talking about a team that won 26 games last year, did not make the NCAA tournament because they had no signature wins. Lost opportunity yesterday against a ranked Michigan team. Took them to overtime, but couldn't finish and seal the deal. But they've got to press on. I mean, despite the lost opportunity, this team, Xavier, is good enough to do some damage in the A-10. This could be a quality win for Creighton if they can prevail later on in the season, as Xavier has the potential to be a ranked team. Xavier, on the other hand, high expectations from the athletic Jordan Crawford, but Jason Love, big man in the middle, 21 and 19. Yesterday, he's emerged so far as the star of this team.
Young shot comes up short, was on the line. We'll stay with Creighton. Sinette Young, Ashford Carter had 21 points and 8 rebounds in yesterday's game before suffering with muscle spasms. And Lawson, starting lineup for Creighton, Jackson, Holloway, Crawford, McLean, and Love with 21 points and 19 rebounds for Xavier.
Now let's go back to Justin Carter for a second. He's playing with a partially torn MCL. And now he's a guy, as you mentioned, that needs to be reckoned with. Darrell Ashford has emerged as the guy with the best point production for Creighton. And Jason Love, we talked about him, most dominant player on the floor yesterday on both ends.
Ball was on threes, his first. Korver was open for a moment. Threes pokes it away.
Nice job by Kenny Threes to get his hand in the passing lane.
Jackson walked with it. Timeout on the floor. Xavier off to a 9-4 lead early on.
I'm a man. Saints at 8:30.
ESPNU's exclusive presentation of college basketball is brought to you by Old Spice. Different scents for different gents.
Welcome back to the semifinal round of the Old Spice Classic, part of Feast Week, presented by Lowe's. We're at the Milk House in Lake Buena Vista, Florida. Xavier with the 5-point lead on Creighton.
One of the problems Creighton had yesterday against Michigan was turning the ball over. 18 turnovers, and Michigan capitalized on it. 23 points. And really easy transition buckets have played Creighton so far in this tournament.
Terrell Holloway with 5 quick points for Xavier. Down low. Runnels gets it out. Witter, the floater, and it falls. First two for Witter. Holloway at the other end. Nice dish down low to the big guy. Freeze. A follow-up for Taylor doesn't go. Harriman had it, lost it, and got it back.
Again, bringing up the high post. Look at the open spot in the middle. Spread floor, open driving lane.
Young shot at the top of the key at the front of the iron. Taylor all alone. What a feed by Holloway. Holloway's got a little jump in his step today.
Well, that's the third time now that Xavier has had guys get behind their defense. Creighton capitalizing. Xavier's got to get a way to solve that. Again, easy transition bucket.
Bodies down low. Runnels and Holloway ran into each other. Coming up later tonight, 5 o'clock Eastern on ESPN2. Our other semifinal matchup between Alabama and Florida State. And then at 7:30 Eastern time, right here on ESPNU, Baylor will battle Iona.
Hard hedge outside by Xavier, trying to be aggressive. When your head's too far, you lose your man. You got to be able to recover.
Ethan Rogge knocks down the three.
Andrew Taylor's got to make sure he steps out and then recovers quickly.
Crawford shot in and out. Boy, he had a rough day of it yesterday. 4-20 from the field and 0-2 thus far. Shot just won't fall.
But you can tell he's got the athleticism. He's got the skill to do some damage. And there's Kenny Lawson Jr.
You like that footwork by the big fella there?
Oh, no question. And that's the reason why Wednesday's practice before the tournament started, Lawson's got to get more touches. Just makes their inside-out game that much more effective.
Tied at 11. Holloway at the other end with the left hand.
Boy, Terrell Holloway just weaving and knifing his way through the defense. Totally under control, though.
Lawson against Love.
Turn the corner.
Witter trying to make a move. Up against Lyons. Fade away. Came up short. And Lyons out with it.
Well, Gavel Witter generously listed at 6 feet. Had a lot of difficulty seeing the basket there in the paint.
Crawford. One-on-one against Young. Korver came to help out. Crawford gets up. Again, it doesn't go. Love, yes! First two for Love.
Once again, Taylor with the hard head. He does recover as there's pressure on the ball.
Young. Trying to get it out to Witter. And the foul is called on Lyons.
We're talking about Jason Love's dominance yesterday in the paint. And here he is kind of biding his time, getting good position, uses the baseline to come back. I'll tell you a guy who did that to perfection was Moses Malone. Back in the day, Moses Malone would use that baseline to get back into the play to be an offensive rebounder, and he's one of the best offensive rebounders in the history of basketball.
What was it like playing against Moses Malone? Because I would watch you on the floor trying to have that guy that wore number two for the 76ers all over you.
Well, Mo was big and obviously a great player. You know, what you try to do is just keep him off the backboard.
Stinnett, Fort lost his footing, got it out to Bach, round the horn. Rogge again for three. Now didn't get the roll that time. Lyons, a bit out of control, but Stinnett coming back to help out, commits the foul.
Well, Xavier getting opportunities, advantage breaks, two on one, sometimes three on one. Several times getting behind the Creighton defense. And, you know, you don't want to give up those easy baskets. You don't want to face too many advantage breaks in a game, particularly when, you know, you got the quickness and the athleticism of Xavier.
14 fouls now on Creighton. The Lyons will shoot two. Lyons sat out last year as a partial qualifier, but still practiced with the team, which has helped him fit in nicely as a redshirt freshman. Dante Jackson back on the floor. He'll replace Jordan Crawford. And Crawford leaves, shaking his head. 0-3 from the field, scoreless.
So you can't let that shake his confidence. You know, he's a scorer. You got to keep shooting the ball. You got to take good shots. And when you're not hitting, you try to get easy shots. You try to get layups, get out on the break, get offensive rebounds. That makes you feel better about yourself.
Lyons all the way with the finger roll. Last touch by Stinnett will stay at this end for Xavier.
And I'm still baffled by how Creighton is allowing the Xavier guards to penetrate all the way to the rim. There's nobody picking him up, and I'm sure Dana Altman's as baffled as I am.
Carter and Ashford come back for Creighton.
Shooter.
And Redford hits.
Do you see that coming, man?
Well, you called it. He is a shooter. Best three-point shooter some say they've ever seen, especially in the Atlantic 10. He was scoreless in 13 minutes of yesterday's game, but knocks down the triple there.
Oh!
Carter! against Jason Love.
And Jason Love, a terrific shot blocker. Carter found a way to get it past Love's arms. And remember, Jason Love blocks shots with his left hand very adeptly. And when you're a righty and you got a shot blocker with a left hand, it's hard. You've got to change your shot.
Love tried to put it on the floor, but walked before he did. 7 different players have scored for Xavier. They lead by 6.
Every day is new.
Welcome back to the Old Spice Classic. The Xavier Musketeers were at the Walt Disney World Resort, and they ventured onto the Tower of Terror. And they're not laughing, folks.
They didn't close their eyes too much.
You've been on the Tower of Terror, and then so have I.
I closed my eyes.
Come on.
Occasionally. Come on, man. I don't like this stuff.
I saw you close your eyes against Mo Malone, but never on the Tower of Terror. Here in 1913, Xavier leads Creighton.
See, I was so much older than then. I'm younger than that now. So I'm not worried.
Andrew Baca. Missed the net. Has slipped a couple of times early on here. He gets the ball and shoots the 3 in the corner. He balanced the net. He has 5. Has struggled a bit from 3-point range so far this season. He's now 6 of 20.
Yeah, the good shooters, you take enough of them, you ultimately find your rhythm and your touch. You just got to take good ones like that one.
Now there's your good shooter, Jordan Crawford.
And the struggles that he's had, the solution, the antidote, would be to take good shots. And as I said, get high percentage shots. Get out on the break more. Get on the offensive glass.
Ashford splits defenders, gets it a box. There's Ashford. Darryl Ashford with 5. And now some pressure from Creighton. Xavier with a tough time getting the ball in. They get it to Love. Dante Jackson barely over the timeline. Holloway had a nice start. 5 quick points. Lawson trying to hang on Love has called for a second foul. Let's learn more about Jordan Crawford as we take a look at our Campus Connection player profile here on ESPNU. The Atlantic 10 Player of the Week, averaged 25 points, 4.5 rebounds, and 4 assists. Out of Detroit, Michigan, transferred from Indiana, and a YouTube sensation after his dunk on the King.
Well, you would hope, before his career is over, that his resume contains more than just dunking on LeBron James in a summer camp. But he's a pretty good player in Indiana, averaged about 10 points a game. You know, the high scoring antics he's had prior to coming to this tournament was against opponents not as good as what he's seeing now. So he's got to step to a different level.
First foul is on Ashford.
And sometimes, you know, out of frustration, he's tried to make too many things happen on his own. Right here, he plays with his teammates, comes off the screen, 19 squares up, and shows you that shooting touch that you know he has.
Where would you like to see him work on his game?
I think a lot of the problems that he has is basically on judgment, understanding the flow and the rhythm of the game, understanding how to get his shots, when to get his shots, but also being able to execute as he did on that last play, execute the jump shot. Execute the play that's given instead of trying to create on his own. And what happens when you start missing shots and you're not shooting well and you're accustomed to putting up big numbers, you start to force things. Resist the force.
And we saw that in yesterday's game when he made only 4 of 20 shots. Freeze with the free throw makes it a 22-19 Xavier lead. The net down to Runnels.
Runnels definitely undersized. Freeze at 7 feet. Runnels 6'6 in the post.
Freeze pokes it away.
kidding?
And they get it to the big fella, blocked away. Ashford came to help Bolton, swatted it into the crowd.
Well, Ashford at 6'4", coming from the weak side. Freeze never saw him. Freeze does a nice job of sealing his man, but you got to locate the defenders. And that time, Freeze never saw Ashford coming and made himself vulnerable to the block.
Holloway all by himself for three. Young down the baseline to Ashford.
Nope, not a good play. Ashford off balance. Get the ball back outside to the top. Reset.
Break into the bucket. Crawford off the glass.
Much more success playing with his teammates.
And now he comes up with a defensive steal. And another bucket. This time a three. And now the score has gotten hot. Feeling finally good about his play.
I think the real Jordan Crawford is standing up.
27-19, Xavier, the 8-point advantage, 8:28 left to play here in the first half.
You're stuck on a treadmill, Lucian.
Jordan Crawford feeling much better about his play over the last minute than he did the entire game yesterday.
Well, one of the things that I mentioned is when you're having a poor shooting day, get out on the fast break. Get some easy baskets, such as the one we saw right there. You start piling up, you know, the made buckets, and suddenly, instead of being 0 for 5 and 0 for 6 and feeling pressured, you got a few crooked numbers on the make side.
Stinnett now with 7 points.
Nice look.
And Taylor off the glass.
Xavier using their size.
Tried to get it to the other end. Ronald let it get away.
Taylor 6'8", Freeze 7 feet. Xavier starting to assert themselves down low.
You know, 6'8", 103.
Welcome back to Walt Disney World, where Xavier leads Creighton 29-21 here in the first half. Luke and Ellison, Len Elmore, and away from the basketball court about 5-10 miles from here, a report has just been released that Tiger Woods in Isleworth was involved in a serious car accident earlier today.
Yeah, I mean, he's in the hospital right now, reported in serious condition, and obviously our thoughts and prayers are with him and his family. But, you know, that's kind of shocking news. It's just on the holiday season, kind of rocks you here.
For more information, we're following the story on ESPN.com, so pull that up on the web.
Right now, Creighton's got to find a way to for them to get some easy baskets, for them to contest, particularly on the offensive glass. They've been doubled up as far as rebounds are concerned. Xavier out-rebounding them 12-6. And Xavier also doing a nice job knocking down some shots, 7 assists on 11 field goals.
It's Jordan Crawford, their leading scorer, has 7. Opened the game missing his first 3 shots.
And I think the difference in this ball game right now has been Xavier's ability on the fast break situation to get behind Creighton and get some easy layups. And also points in the paint. Xavier 14-8 for Creighton.
College basketball action continues on ESPNU later today. 3 games from the 76 Classic. 5 o'clock Eastern, 19th-ranked Clemson will battle Long Beach State. At 9:30 Eastern, 16th-ranked Minnesota and Portland. Gophers outlasted Butler yesterday. And at Michigan, at midnight Eastern, it's number 10 Butler meeting UCLA.
Clemson getting upset yesterday by Texas A&M. And you know, for the last several years now, Clemson has gotten to at least January, the conference play, relatively unscathed. They've got a loss right now. I wonder if that takes the pressure off of Oliver Purnell and his guys.
UCLA
now they can work on getting better.
UCLA losing, would you consider that an upset? Portland's pretty good, right?
Portland's a real deal. There's no question about it. But I think UCLA is going to have a long, long season, primarily because, you know, they've got guys who give the effort, but, you know, most of them are probably recruited to be support players as opposed to feature players. And now that they're in a feature position, it's a hard adjustment.
Tubby Smith got 46 points from his bench in last night's win over Butler.
That was a huge win. Obviously, Butler, highly touted, so-called mid-major, fighting to show that they belong with the big boys.
Millard on the floor for Creighton, along with Stinnett, Harriman, Young, and Korver. That's Harriman for three. Foul called on Redford. His first.
Well, Korver rewarded for his effort. Redford couldn't keep him off the glass, had to resort to pushing and holding, and the officials caught him on the baseline. Offensive rebounders move without it. So easy to block out a guy standing stationary. You keep moving, it makes it more difficult, puts a lot of pressure on the defender.
Tucked away there by Lyons. And Lyons just dodged Young. Ball is loose. And Harriman gets it, and Young is hurting on the floor, and there'll be a timeout now. Stinnett comes over to help out Antoine Young.
Well, there's the poke away right there by Lyons in the fight for the ball. Ooh, there's the dive by Young, and it looks like Lyons' foot caught him in his midsection. See from a different angle right there as Lyons, Young goes down. Lyons' foot is caught underneath Young. It seems akin to falling on a football. You know that hurts.
He had the big bucket in yesterday's game. A game that saw Creighton battle Michigan into overtime. Young went coast to coast, laid it up at the end of regulation time, sending the game into the extra period. Stinnett fires away from three. Redford at the other end, 5 feet behind the line.
You see daylight, you don't waste it.
Stinnett gets it down low, back out, Korver for three. And Harriman commits the foul.
So here's yesterday's time and bucket, 5.7 seconds. Young all the way with the left hand. And that tied it. Forced the game against Michigan in overtime, where Michigan outscored Creighton 14-7. Manny Harris with 7 of those 14 points to seal the deal.
And how about Manny Harris, who almost had another triple-double, had one against Northern Michigan earlier this season, finished up last night's game with 20 points, 11 assists, 9 rebounds.
Didn't get any help today, though, against a very good, very underrated Marquette Golden Eagle team.
Well, came out. Call for the foul on Bob.
And see, those are the kind of fouls that Jason Love has to avoid. I mean, here he is, 30 feet from the basket, drawing a foul just on a head. Down the stretch now. This is a close game situation. Love's probably going to wish that he didn't foul, particularly if he's in foul trouble.
Second foul for Love, so he goes to the bench.
Probably for the rest of the half.
Yeah. Still 5:24 left to play in this first half. Andrew Bach hits the first. Freshman out of Eisenhower High School in Rialto, California. They say he's the best playmaking recruit in the Missouri Valley Conference this year.
Well, he's paying his dues. He's playing behind a couple of really good guards. P. Allen Stinnett, Cavell Witter, guys like that. He'll pay his dues and he'll get his chance. Witter, a senior.
Nice. Finds Breeze, who throws it down with one hand. How'd you like that ball movement?
Excellent execution. And this time, Freeze didn't go to the basket soft, didn't take any chances of being blocked. He sets the screen, and then on the roll, everybody forgets about him, and he finishes with a flourish.
Ball was on Witter, his first, and Kenny Freeze with the opportunity to convert the three-point play. Fires it out. Witter. Rogge for three. Rogge 1-for-4 from three. Came in leading the team in three-pointers with 10. Jackson for three.
Freeze got caught using two hands to push off. When you're on the weak side and you're a big man, the best course of action, hands up. Use your hips, use your shoulders, kind of establish position. You know, if you need to nudge the guy a little bit further underneath, use your legs and your hips and shoulders to nudge him underneath. Don't use your hands. You use your hands, you get caught every time.
Log on to Facebook today, search ESPNU, become a fan, post your best college basketball photos and comments. Show us your school pride on ESPNU Facebook.
You getting a lot of stuff
photos from this tournament.
Are you getting a lot of stuff on your Facebook address?
Actually, I put that you and I would be doing the game on Facebook this morning. Got some Facebook friends, and that explains why we're getting great ratings today. Foul was on Crawford. That's his first. Are you a Facebook?
No, actually, I'm not. You know, I'd rather remain anonymous.
You have enough friends, don't you?
You never have enough friends.
Let me guess, you're the Twitter type of guy.
No, I'm not, actually. I'm just, you know, I'm an anachronism, man. My head's still in the 70s.
Holloway comes up short. He's gotten a little sloppy here. Witter. Ashford shovel pass. Rogge shot goes.
Ashford very adept at turning that corner on the baseline and finding guys.
8-point lead for Xavier.
That's a quick shot. I know Redford wants to get him up. He's an outstanding three-point shooter, but you got to get guys in position to rebound. You're going to fire him up in transition.
Millard. Back to Ashford. Top of the key. Examining things. Thinking about what he's going to do. He's going to take it right to the bucket. Throws it up. But commits the travel.
And see, that's the mistake he's been making prior to this game. The first real fourth shot that I've seen him take.
33-25 after the Crawford turnover. Creighton shooting only 38% from the floor. They trail by 8 here. 3:16 left to play in the first half. Coming up on our halftime report, we'll preview the UConn-Duke game coming up later on this evening. 5 o'clock Eastern tip from the world's greatest arena, Madison Square Garden. Preseason NIT championship game.
Creighton still using a high post for screens with spreading the floor, keeping the paint open. As they've got a lot of splashes on this team looking for opportunities to blow by their man.
Witter trying to maneuver his way around. Jackson lost his step. Bounce pass, down low, Runnels. Nice pass to Korver. Again, Korver. Had two cracks at it, and then committed the foul. Jerome Dyson against John Shire coming up on ESPN at 5 o'clock tonight. And that number 13 UConn against 7th-ranked Duke battle.
Well, both teams play man-to-man, so that's one of several intriguing matchups.
Who do you expect on Duke to be asked to control Stanley Robinson, who can do a little of everything out there?
Well, I got a feeling it's got to be Kyle Singler, the one who matches him in size and who likes to play out on the perimeter. But remember, Robinson's probably going to have to guard Singler as well, so and that's no easy task either.
Arguably, UConn, the most athletically gifted team in college basketball this year?
I'm certainly they're one of them. I mean, anytime, you know, you have double-digit blocks, you know there are guys out there flying, able to contest shots and doing things athletically. But
at the other end, Lyons lays it up and in after Stinnett turns it over, and Lyons with four.
The top to bottom is still hard to tell. Let's remember, UConn, for 8 consecutive years, has led the nation in blocked shots. So you know they keep a corral of guys who are able to defend the rim. That means they have to be able to get up and have excellent timing.
Xavier's done a nice job of moving the basketball around today.
And that's one of the reasons why they're shooting around 50% from the field right now. Getting guys in position and then finding them. You know, going back door and being able to finish. Right there, as I said before, very well executed play on the screen and roll. But this is one of the things that they began the game with, fast breaking against Creighton, getting behind them and getting easy layups. And, you know, beginning of this tournament on Wednesday during practice, Dana Altman worried about that against Michigan. And I think he'll continue to worry about that until his guys recognize they've got to get back and protect the basket.
Point lead for Xavier. Under 2 minutes to go. Xavier 3-1. Coming off the loss to Marquette. Committed 20 turnovers against the Golden Eagles, and it led to 25 Marquette points. Shot clock under 10 now. Ball goes out of bounds. We'll stay at this end. 8 on the shot clock. You're watching the Old Spice Classic here on ESPNU. Part of Feast Week, presented by Lowe's. Chris Mack calls a timeout. There's a good shot of Chris Mack. He's an assistant coach under Sean Miller, who went to Arizona. Marquette beat Michigan earlier today. They will battle the winner of the Alabama-Florida State game. That contest comes up on ESPN2 at 5 o'clock tonight. They'll play the championship game Sunday night at 7:30 on ESPNU.
Well, you look at Florida State, that's one of those teams that a lot of people aren't expecting a whole lot from, but they've got a good 7-footer in Solomon Alibi. Chris Singleton came up big for them yesterday as well. And when you talk about Alabama, you know, got some pretty good players there. That Anthony Grant, the new coach who succeeded Mark Gottfried, and Michael Green. Nice game yesterday.
We just had a shot there of Chris Mack, who comes back home to Xavier, where he was a pretty good ball player himself in the early 90s.
Yeah, played for Pete Gillen. Known for his intensity.
Holloway with the floater. And Holloway with 9. Justin Carter lost his footing, and they're going to call the foul on McLean. We were talking about the intense Chris Mack, who was the captain of the Xavier squad back in 1991.
What do you
92.
Call an intensity, like right here?
He's fired up, trying to make something happen out there.
That look on his face. Obviously, just a tad older, tad more mature.
Went to the NCAA tournament as a junior.
was a high school coach briefly, returned in 1999 as Skip Prosser's director of basketball operations. That went with Prosser to Wake Forest. Came back to Xavier as an assistant under Sean Miller. And then Miller went to Arizona, and the athletic director felt that Mac had as good a relationship as anyone with the players and gave him the head coaching job.
Well, Chris Mack attributes, you know, his development as a coach to the late Skip Prosser, calling him his mentor.
Rodney to the line. The foul was on Taylor, his first. Miller comes back. Runnels to the bench.
Creighton trying to creep back into this ball game, showing some signs of life on the offensive glass. But it's defensively where they've got to be able to string together some stops in this last minute or so to try to get under the double digits deficit.
Redford looking for room, defended by Carter. Under a minute here in the first half. Under 10 seconds now on the shot clock. Here comes Holloway. Redford throws up the three. Knocked around on the ground. Carter needs help. Jump ball. Possession arrow in favor of Xavier.
Good hustle by both teams that time. Again, though, but poor execution by Xavier. Shot clock running down. And Brad Redford, I don't care how good of a three-point shooter you are in that kind of situation, you got to get a better shot than that. 5 feet beyond the arc. And as you said, just hoisted it up there. Look at this, wide open.
Well, they got it to Taylor down low, and Taylor is fouled by Rogge. And Taylor back to the line. Darrell Ashford, our Star Watch Creighton player at the beginning of the broadcast, 5 points thus far. And there's Jason Love, only 2 points and three rebounds. Why has Love struggled?
Well, one, he's been on the bench. He's been in foul trouble the last 5 minutes or so. But more importantly, I think the pace of this game doesn't allow him to get the position that he needs to be effective on the offensive end. Defensively, Creighton is, you know, putting up a lot of jump shots, so he's not going to be, from a statistical standpoint, not going to be as impressive blocking shots. But it's really the foul trouble that's gotten Love, you know, seat on the bench.
Love with two fouls. Creighton will play for the final shot here in the first half. Box looking for room. Under 5 seconds. Rogge throws up the three and hits it at the buzzer. Shot by Ethan Rogge. Leads the team in threes and nails one, 6 feet behind the three-point line.
Much better execution. A cross-court pass through the teeth of the Xavier defense results in that three-pointer. Looking to double team right now, forces the defense to shift. And Rogge, no hesitation, spotted up, squared up, and knocked it down. And Creighton playing 12 guys, man. They may have the fresh legs in the second half.
Got 39-31. Xavier still leads at the break. Our halftime report comes up with Ryan Byrne, a UConn Duke preview next.
ESPNU's exclusive presentation of college basketball is brought to you by Lowe's. Make your home the happiest.
Welcome into our college basketball studios. Ryan Burr along with Hubert Davis as we get you set for the big 5 o'clock matchup, Madison Square Garden tonight. Of course, we're talking about Duke and UConn. Anytime these two legendary powerhouses meet, it's a big game. Usually decides who goes to the Final Four. Tonight, we get it in November.
Well, terrific guard play on both teams. Looking at Nolan Smith being able to put the ball on the floor, knock down perimeter jump shot. John Shire, one of the best guards in the country. Then Kimball Walker and Jerome Dyson, guys that can put the ball on the floor, penetrate, outstanding defensive players as well. It's going to be a good matchup in the backcourt.
Schools have met 8 times all time. Hubert, the two of the last three, have been at the Final Four. So clearly that tells you all you need to know about how good these two teams have been recently. Should be a lot of fun at the Garden, 5 o'clock today. When you look at this game now, and kind of, it's still so early. We're not sure about identity or what direction teams will go, but players that you think can be difference makers.
Well, I think it's going to be fun to watch at the small forward position. I mean, you have two of the better small forwards in the country, and you got Kyle Singel and also Stanley Robinson. And Stanley Robinson of UConn, you know, throughout his career, has been up and down, but he was consistent late last year in conference play and has been absolutely terrific in terms of defending, rebounding the basketball, scoring on the offensive end. I think he's the most versatile defender in the country. At 6'9", he can guard all five different positions. And on the offensive end this year, been able to knock down perimeter jump shots, put the ball on the floor, also post up. But he's going up against Kyle Singler, who I think is the best small forward in the country. Defensively, he can guard a number of positions. But on the offensive end, he doesn't have a weakness. He can post up down low on the paint. He can take a bigger defender out on the perimeter, put the ball on the floor. He's a terrific passer, and he can shoot so effectively from three-point range. So I know we're talking about UConn and Duke, but at that small forward position, that could determine who wins this game.
Players will decide it on the court, but the guys on the sidelines pretty good as well. Two of the legendary Hall of Fame coaches in the game. In fact, they are currently 1-2 amongst career wings with active head coaches. Coach K, 838. Coach Calhoun, 809. Over 1,600 wins on the floor tonight at Madison Square Garden. You played, obviously, a lot in your career against Coach K, but when you hear Calhoun and Krzyzewski, what comes to mind?
Consistency. They always have their teams prepared, and when you look at UConn, you look at Duke, regardless of the talent out there on the floor, their teams play hard all the time on both ends of the floor on every possession, and both of these teams lost a lot in terms of the NBA draft, but they bring back Well, Kemba Walker, first time in the starting lineup. You can see what he can do on both ends of the floor. Nolan Smith, first time in the lineup at the point guard position for Duke. So he gets players ready out there on the floor, and it's going to be fun to watch at 5 o'clock.
And championship game, Madison Square Garden, Duke and UConn, enough said. Out in Anaheim in California, pretty good game coming up as well this afternoon as we get Minnesota. A team that really has looked good so far, beating Butler, and they will get Portland, who just flattened UCLA. What are you expecting here?
Well, Portland's a good basketball team, and they're in the West Coast Conference. It's a team that is very experienced, can really shoot the basketball, have a great backcourt, and Nick Ravio and TJ Campbell that can really shoot the ball from three-point range. Luke Sikma can give them consistent points in the paint. But they're going against a Minnesota team that a lot of people aren't talking about in the Big Ten, but it's an outstanding defensive team. Have two great shot blockers in Colton Iverson. Also, Ralph Sampson III. Their point guard, Al Nolan, defensive player, can really penetrate and get the ball into the middle. And when they throw the ball down low on the post, penetrate and get into the lane, good things happen. They get to the free throw line, they get points in the paint, and they get wide open three-point jump shots. We talked about this yesterday. The one weakness for Minnesota is being able to consistently knock down that perimeter jump shot. Blake Harfarber was able to do that yesterday. Let's see if he can do it today.
And that's an interesting point because Portland will play that 2-3 zone
yes,
that really baffles UCLA 47 points. When you look at where the Bruins are now, one of the worst losses ever, how surprised or not surprised with when you see what they've lost?
Well, I'm not surprised. This is going to be an up and down year for UCLA. They just do not have the talent to be able to compete and beat the best teams in the country. But, I mean, first of all, they have an outstanding coach in Ben Holland. They're going to get better defensively. They've got to get healthy. And then you look at the Pac-10. Overall, as a conference, it's down this year. We've talked about Cal and Washington being good teams in the Pac-10, but they're not considered elite teams. So once UCLA gets healthy, this is a team that I think is going to be competitive in a Pac-10. But we talked about how many players they lost. In the last 4 years, they've lost four point guards to the NBA, first-round draft picks. You cannot recover from that.
Yeah, and they haven't so far. So it should be a good one there, Minnesota and Portland. Creighton, Xavier, that's what game is coming up next, the second half action. For Hubert, I'm Brian. Enjoy the rest of the game, everyone.
Welcome to ESPN's Feast Week, presented by Lowe's.
To the Old Spice Classic. We're at the break. Xavier leads Creighton 39-31. Feast Week presented by Lowe's here on ESPNU. Glad you could join us. Luke Cadellis alongside Glenn Elmore. And Musketeers controlled the play the entire way in the first quarter, led from start until the break, and they had great balance. All nine players that played for Xavier scored.
Well, the biggest reason they've been able to score, fast break situations, Creighton not getting back quickly enough and allowing a layup, sometimes going coast to coast. Xavier shooting 52% from the field. You take out the 3 of 9 from beyond the arc, they're shooting 12 of 20 inside the arc. 18 points in the paint to 10. But Creighton finishes up nicely now, feeling better about themselves. Nice execution on that three-pointer by Rogge. And with a 12-man rotation, no one playing over 13 minutes, Creighton may have the fresher legs going on a stretch if they can close this lead.
Xavier shot 52% from the field, 6-0 on fast break points, out-rebounded Creighton 22-15, and scored 10 points off of 7 Blue Jay turnovers. Now, in case you're just tuning in, earlier in the broadcast, we reported a story away from the basketball court involving golfer Tiger Woods. Now, Woods was seriously injured in a car accident earlier this morning. This is reported by the Florida Highway Patrol. Woods apparently pulled out of his driveway in the Isleworth community where he lives about 2:25 a.m. this morning. He struck a fire hydrant, then drove into a tree at his neighbor's property. Woods was then transported to Health Central Hospital, where he is in serious condition right now. No other information about his condition has been released, but for more on the story, of course, you should go to ESPN News and ESPN.com. Again, we're at the break. Second half coming your way. Xavier leads Creighton by 8, 39-31.
ESPNU's exclusive presentation of college basketball is brought to you by Lowe's. Make your home the happiest place to be this holiday season. Lowe's, let's build something together.
Xavier leads Creighton 39-31 as we get set to start the second half of this game. Feast Week presented by Lowe's here at the Old Spice Classic. Moments ago, I just reported about Tiger Woods' condition, and now reports on ESPN.com just moments ago are that Tiger Woods has been released from the hospital. Again, for more on the story, tune into ESPN News or go to ESPN.com. Here it's 39-31. Xavier has led the entire game. Justin Carter all the way to the bucket with the left hand, and Ashford is there to clean up.
I was going to say, Justin Carter is one of those guys that Creighton would sorely love to get on track here. Only 3 points in 10 minutes of play. Yesterday, in 24 minutes of play, 21 points and 8 rebounds.
Holloway gets it ahead to McLean. McLean with the right-handed hook in the lane over Lawson.
And Lawson's got to get his hands up. McLean just walked him to the basket, got him in position for that jump hook.
Ashford pulls up inside the line. Crawford examines the floor, then decides to pull it out behind the back, pulls up, and hits. 9 for Crawford.
4-7 from the field, also a far cry from woeful shooting yesterday. And again, it's all about confidence. You know, you start putting some of those crooked numbers in front of field goal attempts, and you start feeling good about yourself and more confident about what you're doing out there.
Made only 4-20 shots yesterday. Carter walks with it.
Yeah, Carter trying to get himself on track a little bit, maybe doing too much. Tell you, Jordan Crawford, now, once again, trying to create on his own, but that time much more under control, much more squared up, although he looks like he's limping a little bit.
He missed his senior year of high school with a leg injury. Then started his collegiate career at Indiana before transferring to Xavier, and he knocks down the three there, so he's just feeling it now.
Yeah, and that was perfectly within his rhythm and flow. You see him use the screen and circle back to get the jump shot.
Lawson too hard off the glass.
Creighton just having a hard time scoring right now. They're main guys aren't really getting off. The leading scorer for them is Ethan Rogge off the bench with 10 points.
...13-point lead for Xavier. Musketeers were 27-8 last season, 12-4, won its third straight Atlantic 10 regular season title, and made its fourth straight NCAA appearance.
And that's a good way to get back into this ballgame, put pressure on Xavier's front line. You know, Kenny Lawson Jr. can do some damage down low, get him the ball. He seems to be kind of developing a hot hand right now.
Lawson at 10 points, 9 rebounds against Michigan. He's never had a double-double in his career. Crawford. Lawson came to help out.
Extra pass.
And there's Holloway for three. Well, Holloway's looked good the entire game. Opened up with 5 quick points, now has a dozen.
Pretty basketball, a penetration and kick by Crawford, and the extra pass gets the wide open jump.
Lawson, the right-handed hook, missed everything. Carter there, and finishes.
Well, Jason Love definitely bothered Kenny Lawson on that jump hook. Love's length and reputation.
Love had 5 blocks yesterday.
And he doesn't look like the same guy. That time he received the ball, that was kind of a weak shot that he went up with to his left.
Not near the energy that he had in yesterday's loss. To Marquette. Carter tried to spin around Love.
Gotta look at it. Gotta look at it.
Boy, had the open shot. Passed it up down low. Lawson off the glass. Nothing much McLean could do.
Again, good ball movement by Creighton. As we saw in the first game, this deficit can get close if Creighton.
And McLean has his shot partially deflected by Lawson.
If they can string together some stops, much the same way Michigan could have gotten back into their ball game if they were able to string together some stops. It wasn't their offense, it was their defense. They started trading baskets, they have to get behind.
Bigger roll for Ashford doesn't go. No look pass, Holloway on the wing. The net has it knocked out of bounds by Crawford. Timeout on the floor. 10-point lead for the Xavier Musketeers. 49-39. Jordan Crawford, much better than yesterday against Marquette. He has a dozen already.
Wizards Heat and Bucks Thunder tonight on.
When credit card debt is the problem, they're the solution.
Leading scorer, Jordan Crawford, and Xavier. Up 10 on Creighton, 49-39. Feast Week presented by Lowe's here at the Old Spice Classic. Crawford with a nice day today, huh, Len?
Yeah, I mean, it was a learning experience yesterday, and apparently he's learned his lessons. For the most part, he's been under control. He's played with his teammates. You know, he's found an opportunity to create, but he's been judicious in when he's taken that opportunity. Only really saw him take one bad shot.
Is what happened yesterday almost to be expected? I mean, this squad had Derrick Brown last year, who moved down to the NBA. B.J. Raymond, C.J. Anderson, some veterans that have been with the Xavier program. And here's Jordan Crawford trying to take over maybe the scorer's role. And yesterday was a good learning experience.
Oh, there's no question about it. It was a good learning experience, not only for him, but for the team. And I think this is a learning experience for the coaches right now, that this young man is able to bounce back, you know, from the adversity of yesterday's poor performance. And he's demonstrating that, you know, he understands the game.
Three ball goes for Rogge, who leads his team in scoring with 13.
Yeah, somebody better find that man, especially around the perimeter.
Shows Creighton over Penn State.
With a freeze, trying to present a target as he had locked his man on his hip, and that time it was delivered properly. It was almost as if he was turned the wrong way, turned the other way, and they said, okay, now you're in position.
7-footer, 265 pounds, now with 5 points. big enough target.
I'd say so. Rocky's wide open. He's the leading scorer for Creighton. He says, give it up. That was a quick shot, though. It kind of got it to him too late. Wasn't in rhythm.
Also grazed the backboard. Six rebounds for Crawford. Down low. Freeze blows at that time. Gets it back. Again, yes! Not to be denied. Kenny Freeze.
Well, two times in a row now, they find Kenny Freeze here on the lob at first. If at first you don't succeed, go back at it again. There you go, and one. And the last time, he's got him locked. Now watch him turn and hold. Give it to me, give it to me. You got to turn the other way, Kenny. The other way. Oh, okay. Thank you.
Good coaching. He misses a free throw.
Can't coach that. The Freeze has played a big part coming off the bench.
7 points, three rebounds for Freeze.
And he's part of that size that Creighton just can't contend with right now. With Lawson on the bench, Freeze in the game. Reynolds at 6'6 is forced to be able to guard the seven-footer and battle inside.
The Old Spice Classic continues tonight on ESPN2. 5 o'clock Eastern, Alabama. Jamal Michael Green, who had 22 yesterday, faces Florida State. 7:30 Eastern on ESPNU. It's Baylor against Iona. The Old Spice Classic, Heart of Feast Week, presented by Lowe's on ESPN2 and ESPNU HD tonight.
Well, you look at Jamichael Green for Alabama, 22 points in their win, and Chris Singleton, solid player for Florida State, the 4 steals. I mean, they're able to get out there and move their feet defensively. All Leonard Hamilton's team have been a strong defensive team.
Ball knocked out of bounds by Crawford. We'll stay with Creighton. 24 on the shot clock. And speaking of about Alabama, their football team, ranked 2nd in the country, losing right now in the second quarter to Auburn, 14-7.
Yeah, it's early, and they're playing at Auburn, and that's obviously the biggest in-state rivalry there is. Bama's shown the ability to come back.
Stinnett to Reynolds. Reynolds had his shot blocked by Freeze out of bounds. 11 still on the shot clock.
Yeah, Reynolds a terrific athlete, baseball and in football. But right now, battling against a 7-footer at 6'6". Got his hands full.
The net right around Jackson, too hard off the board. Goes out of bounds, and Creighton will keep it. Kenny Freeze, Ken Xavier is the most touted recruit, but is also out of shape. Good minutes there from Freeze off the bench. Love comes into the game.
Trying to reset right now. Again, keeping the floor spread, looking to penetrate and find shooters.
Stinnett lost his footing and then just threw it away to Lyons. And Lyons to the other end.
And all afternoon, Xavier has found ways of fast break, beat Creighton down the floor. I don't know if it's a defensive rotation after the shot or what. But Creighton has got to find a way to get somebody back to defend that basket on the break.
Xavier now leads by 13, 55-42.
Connection.com.
The Amateur Athletic Union is one of the nation's oldest and largest nonprofit volunteer sports organizations in the United States, with over 550,000 members and 50,000 volunteers. The AAU hosts 250 championship competitions, over 40 events held annually right here at Disney's Wide World of Sports Complex. And for more information about joining or starting a team, visit www.aausports.org. Here, Creighton leads. Actually, Xavier leads Creighton, 55-42. Feast Week, presented by Lowe's on ESPNU, the Old Spice Classic.
I'll tell you what, Creighton playing into Xavier's hands. 9 turnovers. Xavier's been able to capitalized. 15 points off of those turnovers.
Lawson with a nice turnaround jumper.
Lawson back in the ballgame, and they've got to utilize him. Go to him early and often right now, but it's still about the defense. Creighton has got to make some stops. Xavier shooting 55% from the field. Getting open looks and getting layups. As I said, in transition off of the turnover.
Crawford around the screen from Love, and he knocks down the three. Crawford with 15.
6 of 9 from the field, 3 of 4 from beyond the arc. And as I said before, the real Jordan Crawford is standing up.
Justin Carter at the other end for three.
Justin Carter may be heating up at the right moment, but once again, Creighton has got to find a way to make some stops right now.
Lyons had his shot partially blocked. We'll stay at this end after a timeout.
I'm a man.
Welcome to ESPN's Feast Week, presented by Lowe's.
Creighton's been held to 40% shooting. They trail by 11 here in the second half. Welcome back to the Old Spice Classic, part of Feast Week, presented by Lowe's. I'm Luke Cadellis. Lynn Elmore is alongside. We're at the Milk House at Walt Disney World's Wide World of Sports Complex. Ball on the floor.
And for Xavier, it's been their perimeter guys who've done the damage. Terrell Holloway with 12 points. Jordan Crawford with 15. 11 of 17 between the two of them from the field. Who'd have thought that Jason Love and Jamel McLean would only have 6 points between them, and their team is winning by 11.
Love coming off a 21-point, 19-rebound performance yesterday in the loss to Marquette.
And to stay in that game, they needed every one of those points and rebounds and the 5 blocks. Here, both he and McLean don't necessarily have to be that involved in the offense because of this big lead. As I said, it's been about the perimeter guys on the offensive end. Defensively, they've done a nice job against Creighton.
Carter hurried to the bucket.
Although we said Justin Carter now starting to heat up. 21 points yesterday.
10 today. Cross court, Crawford for three. Boy, just measured up and nailed it.
Not only did he measure up, his heels were about 3 inches away from the sideline.
Collision between Love and Carter fighting down low.
You take a look right there. He is almost on the sideline taking that shot. He could have shot it from press row and still knocked it down. And Justin Carter, we said, this is a guy that got that partially torn left medial collateral ligament and still out there playing like a champ.
Lawson wants it and gets it. Fronts Love, now backs his way in with the right-handed hook. Missed everything. Carter jumps higher than everyone. Back off with it,
So that was one Carter could have kicked back out. Got a feeling he wants to try to do it.
He finishes with a right-handed jam and then looks at his bench. Xavier enjoying its largest lead in this game now at 16.
Another fast break opportunity. That's where Xavier has pushed out this lead.
Jackson alone for three.
The door is opening wider.
Timeout, Dana Altman. And the Xavier crowd on its feet here at the Milk House.
Jamel McLean must have heard me talking about him on the side, saying his team didn't need him on the offensive end. But here, once again, another fast break, hustling back, and then bringing the thunder. Jamel McLean on the finish.
I told you that's with authority.
I told you it was thunder.
It was thunder. Almost took down the rim. 68-49, Xavier in front. Musketeers have played in the NCAA tournament 8 times since 2000. Twice as many appearances as anyone else in the Atlantic 10.
Well, as I mentioned, this is one of those teams that, you know, despite the loss yesterday, you know, they've got strong potential as Jordan Crawford develops, as they learn how to play with their big guys, get them on, involved in the offense on a more consistent basis. You know, you got Crawford, you got Holloway. You know, you got the penetration of Lions. When you need a three-point shot, you got Redford. They've got some pieces to the puzzle, no question about it.
Xavier on an 8-0 run. Stinnett pulls up at the top of the key, bags it. Log on to Facebook today, search ESPNU, become a fan, post your best college basketball photos and comments. Show us your school pride. Again, it's on ESPNU on Facebook. And Stinnett hasn't quit.
Definitely showing, you know, good footwork and agility. He actually had to run all the way around the court.
And Stinnett, a junior who has faced some immaturity issues, 7 technical fouls in the last 2 seasons. We talked about it yesterday. He had 4 last year.
Yeah, I mean, he's maturing. He's getting his emotions under control. He's just a young man that just wants to win, wants to do well so badly that at times he lets his emotions control.
Now you grab you by the jersey.
That was on Miller. There's Stinnett.
They're having fun, hopefully.
Top returning score for Creighton. Team that lost its leading score, Booker Woodfox, Missouri Valley Conference Player of the Year last season, who averaged 16 points a game and shot 48% from 3.
That time Crawford shot it before he got squared up. That's when he has his difficulty. Running a little bit too fast.
They called the foul on Freeze. And that's his 3rd.
And these are the opportunities for Chris Mack to be able to impart some knowledge to his big guys. Freeze and Love, you know, guys don't commit fouls so far away from the basket. Those fouls ultimately come to tell on you. You're getting stiffer competition right now. We're going to need every one of those fouls.
Stinnett shoots the 3. Freeze with 4 rebounds now. Crawford, boy, hammered there by Millard. And he'll go to the line.
Well, good job of forcing the issue. Now we're getting a little stuff talking right now. This is not the time. Crawford needed not to say anything. See the push right here. And they were going to make sure that Crawford didn't get the ball up to the basket as he explored. And as he came back, had a few words for Chad Miller. And both of the guys started yapping. The officials now need to calm them down. You see the 2 captains being spoken to. Well, not necessarily captains, but 2 guys that are leaders. Because neither Holloway or Stinnett were involved in that exchange.
There are the numbers on Crawford today. Sitting on 21, and this after yesterday's poor performance that saw him hit only 4 of 20 shots from the field.
And most of those shots taken yesterday were off balance, were forced. Today, much more under control. And when he's right, when he has rhythm, when his form is proper, you can see the touch, you can see the rotation on the ball, the follow through. I mean, look at the free throws. Don't even draw iron.
Good free throw shooter, 78%, goes to the bench.
And that's an excellent move by Chris Mack. You know, with all the talking and obviously the effort, get Crawford off the floor, give him a little few words of encouragement and, you know, some admonishment, and then let him sit down on a good note. You know, you're up 19. You got time for him to cool off.
Just saw a graphic of the success of the Xavier basketball program. 4 straight NCAA tournament appearances, 8th in 9 years last year. Stinnett with it. Foul on the floor. They call it on Freeze, his 4th. Went to the Sweet 16 last season, the Elite 8 the year before, also back in 2004, and Freeze goes to the bench.
Giving a good hand, appreciate the hustle.
Players at Xavier expect to play for conference championships.
goes all the way back to the days of the Midwestern Collegiate Conference days. They've done a lot of that.
Ooh, almost given away by Taylor.
Shot goes for Jackson.
Nice recovery by Andrew Taylor. Almost gave it to the wrong team on that exchange.
22-point game now. Ashford pulls up.
Yeah, Creighton, despite having, you know, 12-man rotation and getting everybody involved and stuff, they just seem to be the tired team. Can't knock down shots, can't finish shots, can't get back on defense.
Holloway thinking about it, takes a three. Ball batted, ends up in Witter's hands. Got a foul on the play. We'll talk about it after a break.
That's the power of the Home Depot.
ESPNU's exclusive presentation of college basketball is brought to you by Old Spice. Different scents for different gents.
Chris Mack and the Xavier Ball Club up 22 right now, 73-51. Feast Week presented by Lowe's here on ESPNU. The Old Spice Classic. Tried to get it down low. Lawson gathered it and scores two. He has 10.
I think as much as Dana Altman would like to get his team back in the ball game, this is a great opportunity, again, it's against a quality opponent, to start trying stuff, to try to see what works and what doesn't from an execution standpoint. That last play was well designed and pretty well executed. The miss on the first one, but, you know, the follow-up by Lawson. And, you know, this is an opportunity to learn how to feed the post and how to get your big fella involved. Boy, Jason Love is bothering Lawson. He's getting up, but he's not even close to the rim.
A couple of tries for Creighton there. They can't convert.
That's the second or third time that I can recall Lawson again on a jump shot. He really points it up there to try to avoid Love's long arm. Now we'll see if they can get Love an opportunity against Lawson.
Jackson pulls up. Porter down low. Lawson finds Rocky for three. Five rebounds for Jackson now. And Creighton only 6 of 22 from three. Love gets it to Redford. Redford, the runner from long range. Inside the line for two.
Again, as much as I said Creighton would like to learn, execute, do some things against a superior opponent, we're looking at Chris Mack trying to get his guys executed as well, despite the big lead.
Later today on ESPNU, three games from the 76 Classic, 5 o'clock Eastern, 19th-ranked Clemson. Lost to Texas A&M last night, 69-60. They take out Long Beach State, 9:30 Eastern. It's number 16, Minnesota and Portland. And then at midnight Eastern time, 10th-ranked Butler meets UCLA. Bruins lost to Portland, their worst loss since 2003. There's the bracket. The winner of West Virginia-Texas A&M game. And that score right now, 58-50. West Virginia leads with 8:51 left. We'll play the Minnesota-Portland victor later today.
Well, Jordan Crawford back in the ballgame.
One guy who didn't come back after halftime was Antoine Young, who got hit in the abdomen. Was apparently throwing up in the locker room during the break. Medical staff for Creighton didn't feel it was serious, but obviously serious enough that he hasn't played here in the second half as Rocky knocks down the three as 16.
Well, anytime you're having a reaction as he has, you know, based upon some kind of contact, you don't want to take any chances out there. And he's sitting on the bench, towel wrapped around him, as we see there, head bowed. Doesn't look like he's having any fun now.
Lyon's shot didn't go, but he'll go to the line. There's Antoine Young. He had the big shot yesterday that sent the Creighton-Michigan game into overtime. Went coast to coast, laid it up at the end of regulation time. Went in for two. But then Manny Harris took over in the extra five-minute period, and Harris finished up almost with a triple-double. Had 20 points, 9 rebounds, and 11 assists. Would have been his second triple-double already this season. He had one in the opener against Northern Michigan.
The one thing he needed was some help. Again, Deshaun Sims, you know, not really providing the offensive spark that he normally does. He kind of compliment Manny Harris. The same thing with LaVar Lucas Perry, just difficult, you know, against a pretty good defense in Marquette.
Bach is fouled, going to the bucket. Earlier today, Michigan and Marquette. There's Manny Harris.
Well, he started off like that, but I tell you, the assertiveness of Marquette on offense, just attack, attack, attack off the bounce, whether it was zone or man, really set Michigan on its heels. And, you know, to some extent, I think maybe Wolverines, despite watching Marquette against Xavier, they might have been surprised with not only the athleticism, you know, obviously the attitude of going right at them, but also some of the strength inside, and certainly the defense. The defense for Marquette was very sticky. It really didn't allow Michigan save Manny Harris, didn't allow them to really do what they wanted to do. Took them out of their rhythm, out of their sequence.
Well, I'm sure there's a Creighton fan or two watching the broadcast, scratching their head right now and saying, boy, how do we go to overtime against the 15th-ranked team in the country, and now we're getting blown out by Xavier?
Well, some of it might be attitude, disappointment that lingers. You know, there was emotion and excitement and, you know, a real feel like they could accomplish something yesterday. And after losing, you get deflated sometimes. And, you know, that's what you have to do. You have to bounce back. As I said at the beginning of the telecast, you got to press on. Because had Creighton been able to compete with this team...
Boy, did Lyons get high there.
I'm impressed with Mark Lyons. The freshman is just, you know, no quit on in him and no backing. He doesn't mind dribbling into a whole lot of big guys. But just going back to the point, you know, this is a good Xavier team, as I said before, that ultimately will do some damage in the A-10. And I think that this is a team that could be ranked at some point in time. And had Creighton been able to be competitive and maybe pull off the upset, you know, they would have accomplished pretty much the same thing that they would have accomplished in beating Michigan. Now, this tournament presented that last opportunity maybe to get a so-called quality win and get to the NCAA tournament without having to win the Missouri Valley Conference.
Timeout on the floor. Xavier up 19. Creighton shooting only 35% from the floor. Turned over the basketball 10 times. Meantime, Xavier 55% from the floor. And that tells you why it's a 19-point game right now. And Bach calls a timeout. Couldn't get the ball in. We'll keep it here and look at the Old Spice 2010 field. Ready for this? Boston College, Cal, Georgia, Manhattan. The Irish, Temple, Texas A&M, and Wisconsin. This is your fourth season here, Lenny.
Mm-hmm.
So, in a nice crowd, just a great, terrific four-day tournament. They play actually on three of the 4 days. Saturday is an off day. I'm excited about next year already. I hope they invite me back.
I'm sure you'll
Can you throw a good word in for me? Because you're a veteran now.
The invitation will be in the mail, man. Don't worry about it. But I tell you, this, if you love basketball and obviously you follow your team, this is a great opportunity. You get to come watch quality basketball, you know, be part of the buzz. Also get a chance to
go to Disney World.
Go to the theme park. That's right. Spend some time there.
Spend a little time with Mickey Mouse. Mickey's come to the games.
Eat some turkey. Nice pass.
Runnels lays it up and in.
Yeah, like I said, these are teaching moments right now. You come out of a timeout, play develops, designed, and it develops, and you execute nicely. These are the positives that come out of what is right now a reasonably negative experience for Creighton in this game.
Well, we were talking about Creighton's missed opportunity here. They almost knock off 15th-ranked Michigan. Looks like they're going to lose here to a Xavier squad, the defending Atlantic 10 champ. His Lions has followed going to the bucket, and Creighton has a difficult time scheduling, getting teams to Omaha from power conferences. Nebraska, really the only one that visits the Quest Center this season, other than the Missouri Valley schedule. And you and I were talking during the break. I told you that really left on the non-conference schedule, New Mexico and George Mason, two schools that even if you win really aren't going to get the committee's attention. And this team last year won 26 games and couldn't get into the NCAA tournament.
Yeah, that's why these early season tournaments are so important to teams of the status of Creighton, that are quality teams and quality programs that, you know, kind of rule their area of college basketball. But, you know, when it comes time to get on that NCAA tournament radar screen early, you've got to be able to pull off one of these upsets. You know, you're looking at Portland, that's the team now that people are going to reckon with. Even though UCLA is not ranked, and the expectation was that they weren't going to do what they needed to do, their reputation was enough to get Portland on the radar screen.
Lions commits the charge. Actually thought that the foul was going to go in his favor.
Mark Lyons has been penetrating and dancing in the paint all day. Very aggressive point guard who pushes the ball up the floor. I'm very impressed with him. But again, it's a lot of freshmen, you know. It's all about judgment. And you got to take each play as a lesson.
Rogge has learned a lesson in this game. That shoot the three as often as possible. He's got 19 points right now. And that was his 11th three-point attempt. He's knocked down five of them. You ready to pick our Old Spice player of the game?
Am I ready to pick it?
Yeah. A Lion shot doesn't go.
Well, I've been told it's been picked for us by powers that be. Our producer, Josh Hoffman, made the executive decision. Jordan Crawford and I agree with it.
Good call. There's Jordan Crawford's numbers. 22 points, 4 of 5 from 3, 7 rebounds, and he is our Old Spice player of the game, coming off a rough effort yesterday against Marquette, a game that saw him make only 4 20 shots.
And I like the bounce back attitude by Jordan Crawford again. An opportunity to really demonstrate his skills. And we're talking about demonstrating skills. Jason Love showed his potential yesterday. Today, you know, you get to a point where things aren't working, but you notice your team doesn't need you. You kind of relax a little bit. But hopefully Love will use this game as a springboard to be able to bounce back pretty much the way Jordan Crawford bounced back from yesterday's game.
Love, a three-year starter. He had 21 points and 19 rebounds in the loss yesterday. You saw his numbers today. Brian Walsh into the game. Coming up shortly on ESPN. About 40 minutes away. UConn and Duke. I'm told 35 minutes away.
Tick, 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 tick.
Madison Square Garden. We've been talking about it for 2 days.
Mm-hmm. And now it's about to be on.
Turnaround jumper by Rogge off the glass.
I know somebody's earning more playing time right now.
Rogge with a career-high 21 right now. The freshman out of Eden Prairie, Minnesota.
And you can tell he touches the ball with confidence, man. He's facing the basket, ready to shoot.
Under a minute to go. Down low, Jason Love, double team. Needs help, splits defenders, lost it. Carter. Down low, Runnels up and in.
And you see Reynolds, those broad shoulders, just made room for himself down low and went up strong. Again, this Creighton team has demonstrated that, you know, they can play with just about anybody. Today wasn't their day. And there's no question about it, but maybe it was the emotional, the disappointment of getting so close yesterday in overtime. But, you know, they're a team to be reckoned with, and you kind of hope that, you know, they have an opportunity to do what they need to do to get to the NCAA tournament after winning 26 games last year. Sounds like they deserve to be there this year.
Chris Mack's club improves to 4-1, led by Jordan Crawford. Crawford finished up with 22 points, 7 rebounds, 8 of 12 from the field, 4 of 5 from 3, Jordan Crawford was. The Atlantic 10 Conference Player of the Week last week. Kenny Freese played well off the bench as well. Better days ahead for Jason Love. Love struggled in this one. Love had only 4 points and 5 rebounds. 80-67, Xavier wins over Creighton. Let's get it over to Len Elmore. We will shortly. Lenny will be joined by Chris Mack, the head coach. Lenny, take it away. We'll get it to Lenny momentarily. Trying to hook up Len. Len getting ready to talk with the head coach of the Xavier Musketeers. Coming up later in our other semifinal round matchup, yeah, it'll be Alabama and Florida State. Final score 80-67. Xavier beats Creighton. Now let's go to Len Elmore.
Chris, terrific win by you guys today. A little bit better performance than yesterday, but it was convincing enough to recognize that you guys have some pretty good potential.
We do. Our kids were awfully disappointed, both in the locker room and back at the hotel last night. The nice thing about a tournament like this, Lynn, is you get a chance to sort of get that bitter taste out of your mouth awfully quickly, and it was good that we came back today and responded.
Well, I'll tell you what was admirable, in my mind at least, in watching Jordan Crawford, who's come with a lot of ballyhoo, didn't play particularly well yesterday, but his attitude to bounce back today, had a strong game.
Sort of microcosm of our team. You know, we didn't play well yesterday. Jordan didn't play as well as he would have liked. Came back today. Not only did he have a great performance, but I thought our team was much better on the defensive end.
All right, how do you finish this tournament with your team? What are you going and tell them?
Well, hopefully the same way we did today. You know, and I know we're going to play, you know, a very strong team. You know, we're either going to be facing Baylor and or Florida State, if I'm not mistaken, or Iona, I'm sorry. So we know that, you know, on Sunday, if we can finish the deal 2-1, be a great trip for our team.
Well, congratulations on a good win, and look forward to seeing you on Sunday.
Thanks, Len. I appreciate it.
All right, Lenny Elmore alongside the head coach of the Xavier Musketeers, Chris Mack. Xavier improves to 4-1, knocks off Creighton today 80-67. This has been an exclusive presentation of ESPN, the worldwide leader in sports, coming up at 5 o'clock Eastern time here on ESPNU. More of the 76 Classic, part of Feast Week. 19th-ranked Clemson and Long Beach State coming your way. For Lenny Elmore and our entire ESPN crew, I am Luke Cadellis. So long from Lake Buena Vista, Florida. 76 has...